Every engine has its quirks, and if you don't know them, they can be infuriating. In this video, we will show you 10 things you might do wrong and how you can prevent or handle them. You know, we are basically experts in making mistakes, some of which have cost us hours.
Let us start with a very, very important one. A weight, or how old people call it, yield. If you are not careful, a weight can make your life really difficult. First of all, the control flow is brain melting. When you await a signal, the execution stops immediately where it is, as if you returned. The engine makes a note to continue the execution when the signal is emitted. This has a ton of weird consequences. First of all, when you are reacting to a signal that comes from the physics engine, you are in some kind of query flush point of time. This method is connected to the body entered signal of the area, and it disables the collision of bodies entering it, and it triggers this error. No big deal, you can set a property deferred. The same error can appear when you add physics bodies or areas to the scene tree. Here you can use call deferred. The next thing is that nothing would prevent you from awaiting in the same spot twice or once per frame. So if you awaited a process loop every frame, a bunch of execution contexts stack up, and when the signal comes, they all resolve, executing many times. Be careful when awaiting reuse timers too. When you stop the timer, the await is not activated. When you later restart the timer and it times out, the await will trigger. The worst one, however, is that when the awaiting object vanishes because of whatever reason, the execution context does not get removed, leading to an error when the signal finally comes. I also assume this is a memory leak. This is typically not a problem when the awaiting object is an autoload singleton, because you usually don't delete those. But in any other case, I would rather use a signal instead. You can use Connect OneShot. It's less of a headache, believe me. And now, a word about our sponsor, Raid Shadow Legends.
Let me tell you a secret about a hidden gem of a game. Okay, you might have already heard about it. I even have reason to believe that it's one of the most influential mobile games of all time. Raid Shadow Legends. Raid's got a ton of champions, over 600 now, and all of them come from unique factions, all with their own history in the world of Talaria.
The elves in Raid are pretty awesome. They formed civilization like thousands of years ago, surviving orc rampages and the collapse of the Lizardman Empire. And through all of that, they remain so cute. But this dude, Zyroth, got into their heads and created the power-obsessed Dark Elves. And they tried to convert the whole kingdom of Avaria to shadow magic, because they thought it's cool and edgy. And the whole kingdom descended into brutal civil war. But in the end, the Dark Elves got exiled, and Avaria was rebuilt. Now it is the brightest, richest, and most powerful country in the realm of Talaria. My favorite High Elven champion from Raid is Ares. She's super strong, and I like her armor. And this month, Raid's got a full schedule of special events and activities, including Forge Pass Season 3, with amazing rewards such as a limited edition artifact set. Raid's also bringing out some new champions and some awesome looking champion skins for the incredible Madame Ceres. Later this month, Raid is giving everybody's favorite champion the upgrade he deserves. Death Knight is becoming a legendary champion. I can't wait to see how the ultimate Death Knight turns out.
This is the best time to get started in Raid. And if you click my link in the description or scan this QR code here on the screen, you'll get bonuses worth $30.
We are talking a free epic champion Rector Drath, 200k silver, 1 energy refill, 1 XP boost, and 1 engine shard. All this treasure will be waiting for you here.
Number 2. Not making stuff unique. Resources are really cool and allow you to keep stuff once that you only need once. But sometimes it's difficult to see which resources are used where. You can right-click on the file in the File System tab and select View Owners to check this, but it's a bit of a hassle. Still, there are some ways resources can get you. First, animations are resources. It has gotten better in Godot 3.5, where you can finally duplicate them on paste. Keep in mind, they might be shared and you might need to duplicate them. Second, hierarchical resources need to be duplicated from top to bottom. When you miss a level or mess up the order, it will not work. Luckily, Godot 4 offers the option to make sub-resources unique with Make Unique Recursive.
Number 3. Starting and stopping animations and tweens. When you call play on an animation player, it stops the current animation and starts the one you play. Except if the animation you want to start is already playing. It does not restart in this case, which I find odd. So just keep that in mind and call stop manually before starting the animation again. So let's take a look at tweens. If you want to restart a tween in Godot 3, do not forget to call remove all and maybe stop all to be safe. Only one might be necessary, but this behavior changed recently and it might change again. If you do not reset a tween, the track stays there and might restart when you start the tween again. The Sindri tweens, that are simply called tweens in Godot 4, are even more savage. You have to kill them, and then create a new tween. And do not instantiate tweeners directly to call tween property on them. Let the Sindri tween do this.
Number 4. Checking node is null instead of is instance valid. Sometimes you want to know if a node is deleted, and you are tempted to just check it for null. This does not always work. It might be fine if you are the object deleting the node, but if another object deleted it, your reference is not set to null. You might get this weird error where the debugger says the variable is null even though you null checked it. Your script sees that differently. Use is instance valid instead. It is clunkier, but, well, it works. By the way, if this was helpful to you so far, please let YouTube know by dropping a like so more people can see this.
Number 5. Sindri timer and tweens pause behavior. Just keep in mind that Sindri timer and the new Sindri tweens do not know by default if they should pause when the game is paused. By default, the pause mode of a tween is the one of the node it is bound to, which is the node you called create tween on. If you use get tree create tween, the tween is always paused with the Sindri. If you want to bind it to another node, you can call bind node afterwards. But you can also change the pause mode. Sindri timers will not pause by default unless you specify otherwise by passing false as the second parameter in create timer.
And then there's my personal nemesis. Number 6. Property has vanished in inherited scene. Inherited scenes are so great and I love them and I use them a lot. Especially when you inherit from a script, it often makes sense to also inherit from the scene. But then you remove a node or rename it in the base scene and you get this. And it does not go away. It's only a warning, but it is so annoying. The only fix I know of is to go into the scene file and manually delete or update the offending line. This way you can even preserve the changes if you renamed the node. However, you can prevent this by resetting all properties you changed before deleting the node.
Number 7. Broken post-processing. There may be no easier way to get a bit of polish into your game than good-looking post-processing. I love glow when done carefully, and color correction can be changed at runtime, which is a stupidly easy way to change the feel of a map without much effort. Unfortunately, we had problems getting it to do anything at all sometimes, and this is because some of the effects need 3D as the buffer allocation. Even in a 2D game, which seems like it does not really matter apart from that. So do you guys know of any drawbacks to using 3D? Presumably it has some performance implications, but they don't seem severe.
Number 8. Exporting your project. I don't know if you guys have the same problem, but whenever we export, some things just break. And here's what we noticed does not work. If you use CSV files for tables, which by the way you should because it's great, make sure to add them to the file types exported, or else they will not be in your export. If you dynamically load assets, they might be named differently. So when they have a .import associated with them, you can just always load the import. This will work in all your builds. But gdscript files do not have an import file, and when exported, they get compiled to .gdc by default. So we check for os.hasfeature standalone and append a c to the name in this case.
Number 9. Supporting alternative key layouts. It's easy to forget that there are people out there with weird keyboards. On a German keyboard, Y and Z are flipped, for example. Some guys swear by the Dvorak layout, and then there are the French guys with their XRTI, and there are countless other ones. Luckily, Godot supports physical keys. So it might be an easy fix for you to go into your input actions and switch the WASD controls to physical keys to include those guys.
Number 10. Sound formats. In Godot you can use sound files in many different formats like WAV, MP3 and OGG. And I think OGG needs more love. WAV files are just needlessly large in most cases, and MP3? How shall I say it? It is outdated and overused. You know, I met a guy who led the research group that invented it. And this guy is just too convincing. Good for him, but OGG tends to produce smaller files with better quality. And if you noticed weird little sound delays in your sound effects, these might also be fixed by switching away from MP3. By design, there can be a bit of silence at the start and the end of an MP3 file, which is not great, especially for looping. And you can simply convert them. We use the batch feature of Audacity, for example, so we can convert everything we have all at once.
Many of these mistakes we found while making First of Us Fungeon, a game where you build a character by choosing spells, items and talents from this interconnected talent tree, and sometimes you steal First of Us stuff, which makes him mad. The Steam page is linked in the description, so go wishlist it. We also just released a demo for Killboy 9000, a bullet heaven where you feed your robot Overlord, that you can play for free. It is also linked. Is there a trap you know of? It would be amazing if you shared it with us.